Between the three of these women, they have been hailed by publications like Vanity Fair, Forbes, The Wall Street Journal, Style Watch. They have a gazillion engaged followers between the three of them. And brands like Burberry and Barney's clamor and beg to work with them. They are truly, truly more than bloggers. They are powerhouses. And I want to start, I would like each of you just to talk about how you started, because I think that's the hardest thing, right, is getting started. Can you start with JC?
Sure.
All right. Do you have a mic? Oh, wait, let's go. Sorry.
Hello.
There you go.
It's me. Karaoke? Hi, I'm JC Dupree. My blog is Damsel in Dior. I started my website as a creative outlet when I was bored at work. I actually had real jobs before I started my blog, even though it's definitely a real job now. I studied journalism at DePaul University, worked for various corporations such as NBC, Oprah Winfrey, WGN, Associated Press. I was a writer at heart, and when I was working at E! News, actually, with Kat, a friend of ours, Stephanie Sopcich, was the executive producer on the show, our supervising. And she was like, how do you wear Forever 21 with Chanel and make the entire outfit look like $1 million when really you're just investing in that one good handbag? She's like, you should start a blog. So I did. And it was just really something I did when I was bored at work. And I was in between jobs. And I just started to do it more and more and more. And it slowly started to take off. And here we are 5 years later. And it's just blossomed into this amazing career for me. The entire industry has grown as well. When I started, there were not thousands and thousands of blogs as there are now. So it's definitely a different landscape now. But yeah, that's kind of my story.
That's
my
Hey, you know, it's funny. I've always had a love of fashion, and I actually started working in retail. So I was working at local clothing boutiques, and then I graduated to Calypso, and then Saks. And then I went to college for interior design. And I actually, after a couple of three internships, I realized, oh no, this is not what I want to do. And so I had a little bit of time between when I moved from Arizona to New York, and I thought, you know what, I'm gonna just start a blog. And at first it was all interior design based. And like two people were reading it, literally my mom, his mom, and her friends. And then I moved to New York and I landed a job working in fashion PR, and I got such great experience in that world, and I was holding desk side appointments with editors, and really, you know, working in the garment district inspired me to start sharing my outfits. And so then I made my ex-boyfriend take pictures of my outfits, and I found that people were really responding to it. So that's kind of how I got my start and transitioned from a design blog to a fashion.
You guys keep that one and then we'll share.
So hello. I studied fine arts at Endicott College in the Boston area. And when I graduated, I wasn't sure what I was going to do with an art degree. So I did bartending, like many of my fellow art majors did after graduating. And I was sketching different fashion and beauty looks on the bar napkins, you know, or on the paper that I snuck into work with me. And I just decided to start an Instagram account, documenting these as a bit of my visual portfolio. And like these other ladies, people were responding. I was a bit surprised. And brands started contacting me to do work for them. And I put my full job as a bartender and pursued this full time 2 years ago. Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to start this next question with JC, and some of you have already touched on this, but I think that it takes a huge leap of faith to decide that this is going to be more than a hobby and an actual career. Can you talk about the moment that you decided to just really go for it, and what did you need a backup plan? What was that moment?
I think that moment for me was when I started to make money off the blog, and I was making more money off my blog than I was my actual job. And I just loved doing it so much that I've never woken up in the morning at 7 a.m. because I used to sleep till 1 p.m. Woken up in the morning and been like, oh my gosh, like I can't wait to go work on this thing. And it just, it wasn't like one aha moment. It was just the momentum kept building and building and building for me. And the work just kept coming in. It just felt right. I don't really know how to explain it. I feel like when you're doing what you really love to do, it's just like, you just feel it, you know, and you know in your heart that like, this is what I'm supposed to be doing, because everything kind of falls into place. I feel like if you force something to happen, it's just not really your calling, you know? There were definitely some projects there that I got that helped, you know, with the confidence level of really going for it. But yeah, thankfully I was never like, oh my gosh, what am I gonna do if this doesn't work out? I just didn't even let that thought enter my mind. I was just like, I'm going for it, you know, let's do this thing. So yeah, I think that's kind of.
And Kat, what about you? So when you started, did you have, and you decided to make it, this was gonna be your career, did you have people in your life that were like, what?
100%.
And how did you deal with them?
Yes, so I was doing a PR and social media marketing role for a small fashion jewelry startup. And I was doing that for a year and a half, and I was kind of wearing many hats at the company. And I always say that that experience was so invaluable for me because I learned how to run a business at 23. And after a year and a half, I thought, you know what, let me just, you know, I'm not really happy anymore at this job. Like, I love my blog, it's what I want to do ultimately. Let me just take that leap of faith and quit my job and see what happens. And my parents, who are from Arizona, were like, well, you're not going to move home to Arizona if this fails, so we're not going to bail you out. But that actually, knowing that, gave me that drive and that hustle to really go out and network and, you know, make a name for myself. And so in a way, I thank them now, because I really had to go out and make a name for myself. So I ended up setting up a consulting business, and I thought, what am I good at? I can do social media consulting. So I did that for about 6 months, and then I got a big campaign with Nordstrom, and I thought, okay, you know what, I can support myself, I'm gonna do the blog full time.
And Holly, you're sort of in a category by yourself. I mean, there's not a lot of people doing what you do. And I know you said some brands have started contacting you after seeing your work on social media, but when did you feel like, okay, this can actually, I mean, stop looking for other jobs, real jobs, right? And really make a go of this.
So when I started illustrating, I was getting commissioned a lot by individuals. People wanted me to draw their loved ones' bridal gowns or their family. And I love doing that, but it's a lot of work and nitpicking. So when brands did start approaching me, that's when I decided it's something I can do. Then they're a lot more flexible to work with than individual people, and they trust my vision. So that's kind of when I decided to step away from the odd jobs I was working and pursue it full time.
So we have a lot of people that are just starting out, and I would love to hear what you each wish you had known when you started.
Not everyone's gonna love you, but I knew that. I think I was, that's tough. I know. I wish I would have known that I still have to pay taxes as a blogger, find a good lawyer, a good accountant. I mean, this is a business. It's not just like, oh my God, let's put on a cute outfit and take a picture of it. It's, you know, you're running a business. There's a lot more behind the scenes than just taking a pretty photo. I also wish that I would have just been myself in the beginning. When I first started out, I think I was just trying really hard to like be this person that wasn't really me. I don't know if you guys have heard of the awful website called GoMe, but it's like a hate forum. Where they basically just
don't
hate
go
all
on it.
Yeah,
stay
don't,
away from it.
Don't go on it. About 2 years into my blogging career, I came across this because they were directing traffic to my site. Thanks. I was like, oh, gosh. And they just were hating. I had about 28 pages at the time. And oh, it got to me. I was like, God, this sucks. You know, like, oh, they're just ripping my family apart and doing all these things. And since then, Snapchat came about, which I effing love. And you really don't hear me drop it, go on my Snapchat channel. And that's just the place where I just completely let my hair down. I'm JC there. I don't even think about what I'm putting up there. And ever since I started to do that, the GoMe is now SoMe, which is like positive comments. So now the last 8 pages are all like, oh my gosh, we love her. We thought she was like this fake phony bee, but she's not. She's actually really cool and like doesn't wear makeup, you know, 24/7 or whatever. So I would say just be yourself from the beginning, because that's what makes your brand you. There are no replicates. I know earlier we were asking Lauren, you know, how to set yourself apart. Well, you're you, and no one can replace you and who you are. So I would just say, like, just do you, and that will be the best version of your blog that you can have.
Kat, what do you wish you had known when you started?
So much. And I'm still learning. It's a constant process. And I think that's what's really important, is accepting that you're not going to know it all and just going with the flow and not trying to be so perfect all the time. It is true. Being yourself and being real will get you so much farther. And, you know, just, gosh, I mean, there's so much. Yeah, the lawyer stuff, the accountant stuff. I mean, all the little nitty gritty behind the scenes stuff, I wish I knew, and now I have a great lawyer and accountant. But yeah, it really is just so important to stay true to yourself, learn how to say no. I think in the beginning, you know, when I was just starting off, some contracts came through and I was like, oh, this sounds amazing, but then it didn't feel right in my gut, and I'm really glad that I listened to my gut, because from day one, I've always tried to build a brand, and I think, just, you know, readers can tell if you're genuine or not, and really learning to say no and being confident in that decision.
That's great. And Holly?
Very similar, but I wish I had known the business side of it before I started. And I think it's important, too, to know what your weaknesses are and find a support system that can compensate for what your weaknesses are.
So Kat just brought up a good point about working with brands and sort of maintaining your own brand when partnering with other brands. And I would love to know how you make the decision of who to work with versus who not to, because it's a big money maker, right? And it's probably hard to turn down money. But what's the deciding factor for you?
You know, for me, it's always been about, does this enhance my brand? And I haven't just thought of it as like a blog where I'm gonna go take pictures of my outfits and then that's it. I've always thought really long term, and you know, I would love to have a coffee table book someday. I would love to have a travel series someday. I have a travel app. I really think, is this brand that wants to work with me, is it gonna enhance my brand? And is it gonna be, you know, true to myself, and are my readers gonna think it's organic and genuine? So that's really important, if it's an organic partnership or not, regardless of the amount of money that comes in.
And JC, how do you make those decisions?
I mean, similarly, if I shop at Tory Burch, I want to partner with Tory Burch. You know, it's just whoever I'm interested in, or places I'm interested in going. You know, if a brand reaches out about going to Paris next week, as tempting as that is, I was just there, and I'm tired. I don't really want to go. I'm not just going to go for the money, because then it's going to wear. You know, I'm going to wear it on my face. I'm going to be tired. I'm not going to do a good job. Like, I want to be feeling 100% about it. And you know, I will be the first to admit there's been a couple brands I've partnered with in the past where I wasn't 100%, and the work shows that. And then you feel cruddy about it, and the readers are like, "What?" So I think just kind of mirroring what Kat said, is just, it has to feel right.
Holly, you work with a lot of brands. How do you decide, because you're drawing for them, basically, right? How do you decide who you're going to work with versus who you won't work with?
I think it's a bit easier for me, because when brands are looking at my work, it's very easy to see what my aesthetic is. And they kind of make that determination if I'm a good fit for them or not. But if there is a brand that approaches me that I don't think it's a project that I'd be able to create good work for, I make a recommendation for someone else that might be good for them to work with, and I make sure it's someone that I'm comfortable putting my name with, saying this is a great person, Holly recommended her. But brands are very willing to hear my artistic vision and how the best way I can create work for them that will get their message across.
Support other women as bloggers. That's great. As each of you have grown, has it become harder to maintain that close connection to your followers and your readers? You know, the bigger you get, the more spread thin you are. And so how do you do that? How do you make that personal connection with millions?
I mean, I try to I answer every email and every question. If I don't answer a question on Instagram, it's probably because it's a stupid one. It's like, tap the photo, the credits are on there. But I can say that only so many times and people still don't tap it. I'm just kidding, that was funny. Or they're like, vote for Trump. I'm like, delete, I'm just kidding. Everybody go vote on Tuesday. But no, I just try to engage. I don't know, I think Snapchat's really helped because then people feel closer to me. I mean, please follow me on Snapchat and then you'll find my sense of humor a little bit. You'll get me. I'm not coming across crazy on stage, but I don't know, engaging, talking to people. We're all just like real people.
We are real people. No, I think as my following has grown, I've actually felt more connected to people. And it's been so exciting to get my voice out there and just show, I hope I'm a good example, that if you work hard and you're nice to people, that you can build a great business for yourself and staying true to yourself. And I love when people come up to me. You know, I live here in the city and I'm at brunch with friends, and we'll say, oh, I follow your blog, and that makes me so happy. Or when people say on Instagram, I used your travel app this weekend at the best time in New York, that's been a great way for me to connect with people. So I think as I'm growing, it's just getting better and better.
What about you, Holly?
So I think a great feature, I don't know when this came out, but on the iPhones, how you can pull down and see all your notifications for that day. I don't delete any of those, so at the end of the day, when I have a bit more time, I go through them all and I try to answer as many questions as I can. And if I'm getting a lot of questions about the same thing, I'll do a blog post walking through the steps I use and the different markers I use to get to answer the question that I'm getting frequently. I also do the same thing on Snapchat, so try to create content based off of what people are requesting.
So much of what you do is involves your personal life. If I don't post on Instagram for 3 days, the only person that cares is my mother. You guys don't, right? You have millions of people that are like, what's going on? Where are you? What are you doing? How do you find time just to kind of nurture and be you and engage your personal life versus, and then how do you kind of balance that, right?
That's actually a really good question, and that's something that I think I've struggled with as becoming, you know, growing bigger and bigger. You know, I am a more private person, and so maintaining a sense of, you know, my personal life, and then what do I share, what do I not share. And so for me, I like things very curated. You know, I have that interior design background. So I share less personal stuff, and people know that they can come to me for the, you know, great food recommendations, great travel recommendations, and fashion, and hopefully if they meet me in person, they know I'm a bubbly person. But I refrain from sharing every aspect of my life, because I want to be curated. But I do love how JC does share so much on Snapchat, and it's amazing, and it's like, that is her comfort zone, and so I think whatever is your comfort zone, stay true to that, because that feels good for me, not oversharing, or sharing a lot of my personal life. But I think everybody's so different. So again, find what works for you and go forward with that.
All right, Snapchat queen, how do you
do that? We're just different.
Yeah, we are. Snapchat's one thing. If I go missing on Snapchat for a couple days, people start to be like, are you alive? But with the blog and with Instagram, it's very easy to take a break. You know, I was in New York for 2 days before everyone really knew I was in New York, you know, so I'm still posting like I'm in LA. Sorry, but we do that sometimes. I just need to like lay in bed for a day, or if I'm sick or something like that. But people also like to know that I'm sick, so it's like this weird, I don't know, anyway. That's what Snapchat's for. But yeah, if I take a break, I usually share why, you know, and people are like, yeah, totally, we get it. I don't share anything that, there's a lot I don't share. I don't post photos of my husband, really, ever, hardly, and my family. My brother is okay with it, so it's really just a matter of, yeah, what I'm comfortable sharing. And I'm okay sharing what I'm comfortable about myself. I write a monthly-ish column on the site called Damsel Diaries, and it's usually like a more personal, like, storytelling, like how I'm actually feeling about like having babies one day and things that are much more personal. But I know that, for example, my husband is super reserved. Hey, it's having his photos taken. I'm not going to violate that and keep that part of my life private. So there's certain aspects that I don't really fully share all the time.
And Holly, for you, I mean, you have to create, right? And that takes time. But you also have to make sure you're posting and doing all of that. So how do you balance those two things?
I focus more on the art part, or the creating art, rather than the social media part. But when I'm doing that, I'm focusing so much on the process and the enjoyment of creating artwork that the social media side and the posting side, it kind of comes naturally. And I think if I were to do anything else, it would read the wrong way. People are following me because they like to look at my art and not because they want to see photos of me, which is exactly what I want. I want my art to speak for itself. I don't want to be involved in it in any way, or other than creating it. So. Yeah, that's kind of how I handle it. I just let it happen, and it's more the enjoyment of the art making.
I want to talk about growth, and then we're going to throw it to the audience to get your questions ready. You all have grown way beyond being a blogger and influencer. You have a travel app, there's a jewelry line, there's a lot of different things. So I want to give you, one, all an opportunity to talk about. You work with a zillion brands. I don't know how you keep taking them on. But I want to give you all a chance to talk about what you're working on, and then also how you've grown sort of past that web page or past that Instagram account. Let's start with JC, so you have a lot of projects.
Thank you. I am coming out with a jewelry collection. It's a capsule collection. That's actually why I'm in New York. So a Tina Ryder and a damsel this holiday season. Everybody has to buy some. No, but that happened very easily, actually. My husband actually bought me, this is a great story that answers the question. My husband bought me a necklace for my birthday, which ended up somehow falling off my neck one night in Santa Barbara when I was drinking too much. And I went to the jewelry designer and I was just gonna replace it. I didn't want to tell him that, you know, the $300 necklace he bought me for my birthday I lost. So I reached out to her and I was like, hey, do you still have this necklace? Because I'd like to buy one, because I'm a horrible wife. And we went to lunch, loved each other, went to another lunch, and now here we are doing a partnership together. We just had a great, really, like, just right off the bat, got along really well. I found that partnerships that are forced, or that you're like, I really want to partner with this brand, and you kind of force it to happen, are never as successful. I don't want to name which ones I've had to hunt down and pursue because I just really wanted to do them, but they've never been as successful. And it's crazy because I'm like, I know my brand and I know what will work, but sometimes when you just force feed something, it just doesn't work out. So I think that growth is like any, you know, is in any industry, it's going to be the same. It takes time and experience, and you know, you're not going to master your life, but you can master like each day, and then just keep doing that, and then keep doing that, and you'll just grow organically.
Kat, do you want to talk about your travel app and how that's growing and how you decided on making
my pet project? Yeah, you know, 2 years ago, I love food and travel and good wine, and I started sharing more lifestyle stuff on my Instagram account, and I would notice that people would email me and say, you know, I'm coming into town for a bachelorette weekend, where should I go eat? Or, you know, I saw you were in Paris, where did you stay? And I was becoming like a travel agent, and I thought, okay, I need to find a solution for this. And what's like a handheld, cool, with Love for Cats favorite, you know, city guide, how can I create that? And so I literally worked with a graphic designer, and we found this awesome coder in California, and we built it from scratch. And it launched last November. And I think, you know, that's something that I didn't go into it to try to monetize it. It's free to download, but it's enhanced my brand in more ways than I can even begin to say. And so I think that's a good point to touch on, is that if you're creative, just create something and just, you know, really think about what's useful, what my readers love, and that is going to, again, enhance your brand. And I think the travel app, it's just been such a great way to keep connecting with people. So, and then I also have a travel collection of like leather passport cases with graphic image, which has been great as well, and I've partnered with them for 3 seasons. And that happened really organically too. My mom bought me a planner at Bergdorf's. They do a private Bergdorf's line years ago. And I Instagrammed it, and then they reached out and said, would you want to come to our factory in Long Island? And I thought, oh, sure, okay. And then they said, you know, we love your aesthetic. Would you want to partner on a collection? And it just went from there. So I think it's about, again, just sharing the things you love, and you'll be amazed at maybe the brand that'll contact you or the lunch that could happen, and it can just kind of unfold organically.
And Holly, how do you handle growth, and do you have a five-year plan? What's going on?
So I want to get a lot more into the educational side of things. There's no formal classes for fashion illustration. I think there's more now than there were when I was getting into it. So I'm gonna start a YouTube channel and walk through different tutorials, how to draw the figure, how to render different fabrics. So hopefully make it more available to people and get some people inspired to draw again.
All right, so let's open it up to questions. Oh, right away. Do you want to yell yours? Do you have a loud voice? Do you want to yell it out? Okay, go for it.
So, hi, I'm Holly. I'm a fashion wardrobe stylist in Atlanta, Georgia. And this question is really mostly sorry, but this is for them. It's only because I'm doing a little bit of everything. I'm doing a little bit of social media, a little bit of blogging. You know, I need to blow up, per se. I need to get more clients. I need to get more referrals. My SEO person told me that I had to start a blog, not because everyone's going to read it, everyone's going to care about what I'm doing, but just for SEO purposes, just so people can find me. I need advice on, again, I know partnering, you're like, don't force it, I get that, but I need advice on how to reach more people without me having to be on social media 24 hours a day, because no one has time to do that. So what is your suggestion for someone like me where I really need as many, you know, brands, clients, people, referrals to understand what I do and my brand? What's your recommendation for that? And does it have anything to do with my blog, or is the SEO guy right? Polycat Style.
Polycat Style, you guys. Woo. Go check it out. There's one way.
You know, for me, Pinterest is the number one source of traffic to my blog, and I've really invested a lot of time into photography and, you know, buying a great camera and taking Photoshop and Lightroom classes, and I still suck, but, I mean, you know, it's a work in progress. Photography is way harder than people tell you how hard it is. So, really, if you have strong images on your blog, and you pin those to Pinterest at key times. For example, I always try to pin pictures 7 a.m., 10 a.m., 1 p.m., 4 p.m., there's like key times. Then you'll start getting repins, and then people will be directed to your blog, which will then direct to your website.
Thank you.
Yeah, Pinterest is a topic role for me as well. And I just to mirror what she's saying, if you do have strong images, I don't think it matters how much you're posting, but just to post as consistently as possible. You can sign up with like Statigram, I think it's like Kano Square, where they'll tell you the exact times to be posting based off of the people who are following you and when they're online and the most engaged. So that's what I do now too, because I'm, you know, we're all trying to grow. So I post at certain times, it's actually in my phone. It'll buzz and be like Instagram now. Yeah, I set calendar reminders as to when to post. And I'll be in bed at night, and that's when I catch up on all my other social stuff, but we have a social media posting calendar now, so that we post our tweets, Facebook, Instagram, Pinterest, all at the same time, every day.
What's the name of
it? I think it's Icono Square. It used to be Statigram. There's probably a lot of them. Also, attending seminars and conferences such as this, and networking, and getting your name out, and networking is huge. Huge, 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 which it sounds like you're very passionate and driven and already doing a great job at that. So I think you're on the right path, just be consistent. And maybe even a Facebook ad.
I've tried that.
Doesn't work.
And I mean, it did.
Nothing?
No, I mean.
Okay, don't do that.
All right, let's take another question. Okay, let's go here, and then we're going to start making our way this way.
Made it moments.
Holly, let's start with you.
I was invited to Fashion Week to sketch on the runway, and previous to that, I was at home on my computer watching the Vogue runway app and doing it from there. So when I was in it and finally doing it professionally, that's when I kind of realized, okay, this is awesome, and I'm gonna keep doing it. And when people started appreciating what I was doing for fun anyway, that's kind of when I was fulfilled myself and also making money doing it. So that's when I made it home class.
Me was I really looked up, I still do, to my peers. And when I started out, I looked up to Ami Song and Mumi Neely, and those were like the girls that, the OGs that paved the way. So I think when I started to go to shows and events and they knew my name, I was like, wow, this is cool, and now we're friends. I think that was for me a really big turning point, like just getting their respect.
I think for me, it was that big Nordstrom campaign. That was like 6 months after quitting my job, and I thought, oh, okay, this it's a huge brand that I've shopped up forever, and I should apply to a retail job there. They want to work with me. This is amazing. And then, of course, I mean, meeting DBF a couple weeks ago, that was like another major moment in my life. But the Nordstrom thing, it really, once I had that as a foundation, then other brands started to follow. So, it's a good moment.
All right, I saw some questions. Oh, over here. Go ahead.
When you first started, who took your pictures? How did you take pictures? And how has it evolved to where you guys are now?
My lovely ex-boyfriend took my pictures. Thank you, Tommy, if you're out there. No. And so. Yeah, he works in commercial real estate and had no desire to do photography. And I'd be like, get lower. That's a bad angle. Why do I look so bad? Poor guy. But he was supportive and he helped me for 2 years do it. But I did invest in a really nice camera. It was the Canon Rebel with the like kit lens at first. And then I upgraded and I watched YouTube videos and I learned how to edit my own photos. And that was tremendous.
Yeah, my poor husband. I mean, he stopped taking my photos because we had to save our marriage. He's definitely not a photographer at all. And I took every class and I tried so hard. You guys, photography is hard and I can't do it. I could take Instagram photos all day, but taking photos for the blog is definitely, I think, one of the like biggest challenges is getting the photos right. So if you're not able to take on that amazing talent that photographers have, which I just don't have it, I've tried so hard. I had my husband do it. I'd set up a tripod and get the button and have it in my pocket and be like half fake walking across the street and the tripod. I tried everything. At the end of the day, investing in a photographer is my like number one. Now I have an actual professional photographer who I use consistently. But in the beginning, it was the struggle was real. You're so good. Very sweet.
Okay, I'm gonna keep going until someone from the fabulous Simply Stylist stops, tells me to stop. So we'll go from here.
Can you talk a little about working with your agents and the business side of it between what they bring to you in opportunities versus the organic authentic things that you're just interested in doing. And then the second part of that is this is all mushroomed so much in the past year with almost everyone having an agent. Where do you think what do you think it will look like in 5 years?
I think it depends on the person. I don't have an agent or a manager. I manage everything myself. So I don't think you have to have one. I don't, but I think that it definitely helps certain people. The majority of bloggers do have managers or agents, but it just depends on the person and filling the void as to like where you think you need a support system. I love taking meetings and networking and negotiating my own deals. It's probably my favorite thing to do, but it's also hard to wear both hats. So maybe you guys do have a manager or agent?
I do not have a manager or agent.
I'm
Yeah, because I had that experience working in, you know, PR, and I did sales and marketing. I know how to take desk appointments and write a professional, you know, email and contracts, and I did get a great lawyer. And so I've managed my own blog for the past, I guess, almost 6 years now, and had many people try to come in and manage me. And it's not something that I'm opposed to. If the right person comes up and it feels like a good fit, that's great. But like JC said, I do enjoy meeting people and networking and, you know, really talking through an idea. And maybe that's why people are like, oh, your collaboration seems very organic, because they are, because we came up with them over lunch or over coffee. And I truly let what I love, you know, be conveyed to the brand. And so instead of the brand coming to me and saying, we want you to wear this, and you're going to be in this location, and you're going to say this, it's the opposite. They'll say, where are you going on a trip, and what's inspiring you? And so I'll tell them, and then we'll work from there.
How about you?
I just recently signed with a management, and they're excellent because they understand what I need to be as an artist, but also as an influencer. And they're very quick to communicate that to whatever brand I'm working with. And they allow me to communicate with the brand as well. So I'm involved in all of, from A to Z, the project, which is excellent.
What made you decide you needed that?
What I talked about earlier about knowing your weaknesses, and they fill that void, as you said.
We have time for one more question.
Okay, you went right up.
I was just curious, I know, about how long your blogs have been around, but I was curious around, I know you said your aha moments, but I'm curious more around how long it took you to maybe, like, actually make enough money to where you could say, okay, like, I can really have a career out of this. I'm starting a blog, so it's more around, I have a lot of other lifestyle things going on, so similar to what one of you said, people are always like, how do you not have a blog? But for me, I know very well that I have to go into this with, like, a hard commitment for years. But I'm just curious if it was, like, 6 months and you were like, wow, like, it's coming in, or if it was more like 2 years, 3 years.
That's a good question. Yeah, so I was working full-time, and then I'd go home and blog until midnight for the first year and a half. And then I did my consulting company to make ends meet for 6 months, and I would blog at the same time. So it took me about 2 years to be able to really support myself and make the commitment to blog full-time. But that was, 5 years ago. So times have changed, which is exciting for you, because brands are willing to pay and they see the potential in influencers. And so, back in the day, I would be like, hey, can I host an event for $100 or something? And now it's such a different game changer. And I, really had to tell people, no, I promise I'll sell out of this sweater if I wear it, like, believe in me. And really pitch people, but people just didn't have the budget or weren't willing to pay back then. So the game has changed a little bit, and so hopefully it won't be 2 years for you, but it definitely does take, time and commitment.
Literally my exact answer. I started mine 5 years ago. The industry's definitely changed. It took me 2 years to, like, fully be like, I'm making a full-time salary off of this thing. But, just like Kat, I had freelance gigs and making ends meet after the first year, like 6 months to a year. I was like, oh, this is kind of generating some income. But like she said, the industry's definitely changed, and that was in 2011. And I literally would have to email smaller websites and be like, can I just borrow a top? And then maybe you'll like it, and then we can do something later that's paid, and it's like $200. Yeah, it was hustling. I'll go back.
I think you hit your emotional breaking point when you need to just say, I'm going to stop doing what I'm doing and jump in and do this full time. And you just have to commit to it. And if you invest all you have into what your passion is, it's going to bring all that back to you.
All right. And with that, we have to end.
Thank you. Hold on. Hey guys, thanks for watching, and so glad that you're here. You could just take a moment and subscribe to our channel. You can do it by clicking here, over here, over here or wherever that subscribe button is, just click it. You'll get everything directly sent to you. First to know of all things Simply Stylist. Thank you so much. And if you don't, this dog is coming after you.